A very warm welcome to all our viewers to the third edition of Set This Knowledge series, an initiative wherein we have one expert each month speaking on a variety of topics ranging right from investing to well-being. Set This Wealth Partners was founded in 2007 to provide holistic financial solutions to individuals and families. We at Set This believe in knowledge first, and the knowledge series is one such step to make the investors take informed decisions about the various asset classes. For our third edition, we will venture into the world of debt investments, and we will be joined by Lakshmi Iyer, President and CIO Debt and Head Products at Kotak Mahindra AMC. We are honored to have her as a guest. Lakshmi has been with Kotak Mahindra AMC since the last 20 years. She joined Kotak in 1999 as a fund manager. Prior to working with Kotak, she worked with Credence Analytics Private Limited as a research analyst, where she was tracking the corporate bond market in India and generating the research reports. She was also instrumental in conceiving various financial software tools in collaboration with software and technical teams. She holds an MBA degree from the Narasimha Raoji Institute of Management Studies and loves exploring new places for traveling, is a big food lover and an ardent movie buff. We look forward to having an informative session. Once again, a very warm welcome to all our viewers and to our speaker. I now hand over to Mr. Nilesh Bajaj for taking the discussion ahead.
Thanks, Unnati, for the lovely introduction. In fact, I got to know a lot of things about Lakshmi through the introduction. A very good evening to all our viewers. I'll just take you through how this session is structured. It's a moderated session whereby we will ask Lakshmi our set of questions. In the meantime, if viewers have any questions, they can post it on the comment box and we will take them up at the end of the session. So Lakshmi, we are having a session in February, and this is the month in which many ways, you know, you lay the foundation of our economic activity, because, you know, this is the month where it starts with the union budget. Okay. So, you know, I would like to begin our discussion on the similar lines. So my first question to you is, what impact should the budget 2021 have on yields with the increased government borrowings?
So hi, very good evening to each one of you, and thanks Nilesh for having me over. And I think the mantra for 2021 is tike tak tike raho. I think that's so important because this is the year of vaccination and the year of the hope. And hope is there across the world and including our markets. On your particular question, Nilesh, I think, you know, the way the bond markets have this one unanimous focus on that one number, which is the government of India's borrowing program, because that has a direct bearing on the bond yields. So in this budget, what the government or the FinMin announced was a number which is way beyond the market expectations, which was close to a total gross borrowing of 12 lakh crores. Now that took the market by surprise, and that's the reason we saw a sharp rise in bond yields. Since the day the budget was announced till date, we have seen more than 15 to 20 basis points upward movement on the yield curve, because the markets are just worried about one thing, that okay, you have shown us the way of supply, there is going to be supply week on week. Where is the roadmap towards creating the demand? So the demand-supply equation right now is not matching, which is why the current mood of the market is a little bit somber and we've seen yields on the rise. So that was the single-pointed number which the markets actually took home from the union budget, at least for the fixed income markets.
Okay, so Lakshmi, do you feel, we have seen a good rally in high credit in the last 8-9 months when RBI reduced interest rates? Would this year be difficult for specific high credited government security kind of instruments, citing that with the increased government borrowing?
Certainly, there is high supply. So when the hurdle or the bar is raised, you know, you need to jump with that much more velocity, else you run the risk of falling down. So that exactly is what the mood which epitomizes the current situation. So there is no doubt that if there is no Reserve Bank of India doing a Shah Rukh Khan act, and when I say Shah Rukh Khan act, I'm talking about saying Main Hoon Na and coming into the market with open market bond purchases, or at least giving some clarity on how they plan to conduct this mammoth borrowing program for Government of India, we're going to see yield move in ranges, and those ranges will gradually start shifting higher than lower. So last year, we actually saw the yields in ranges and the yields shifting lower because there were rate cuts. So this year, bereft of any rate cuts, I think the tall task which RBI has is that to play this role of a very strong catalyst to create demand, which is not there right now.
Okay. So, on similar lines, I would, take this, discussion forward. So my second question to you is, now let's talk a little bit about global economic situation. Post-COVID, many central bankers around the world, they pursued an extremely expansionist kind of a policy, during which, during the pandemic, and particularly, by reducing would be the larger social implications of the same.
So the currently, Nilesh, what has happened is that the world has gone into steroid injection mode. Bulk of the year 2020 was the year of injecting steroids or adding weight gain was the case, because the world was fearing malnourishment induced by the pandemic. Year 2021, to my mind, would be the year of liposuction, where you will have to wean out the excess fat. Now, the worry is that not all central bankers are talking the same language. The Central Bank of India, which is the Reserve Bank, has already started normalizing liquidity. So they have announced 2 lakh crore worth of variable reverse repo, which is doing it for a 14-day basis rather than doing it on a daily basis. Whereas, members in ECB are actually sending out Valentine's Day messages saying that we will do whatever it takes to keep the liquidity afloat. So, different contradictory messages from the global economy tells you one thing, that liquidity is going to remain across the world, including India, but with a lag. There is a risk that one runs that this liquidity can prove inflationary, and this inflation monster could actually come back with a vengeance if this vaccine that we're talking about is even half successful as we move into the year 2021. So I think we need to be clearly mindful of this risk and keep watching out for cues on this front.
Okay, so from liposuction to steroids, I think, that's a very good example which you have given, to make our investors understand as to, how things are faring now. Coming to, one more question is, on the interest rate cycle. I think, I get a feeling a lot of investors also talking about they are ready to invest in extremely long dated investments also. This is the first time we have seen investors not talking about if we want to invest for 3 years or we want to invest for 1 year. They're talking about actually investing for 10 years. So, there are 2 questions, but I'll ask you the first question. Are we in a structural low interest rate scenario in India specifically, or it's going the global way that, because of dovishness across the globe from central bankers, we're seeing a similar thing happening in India? Or are we in a structural low interest rate regime right now?
So, bulk of 2020, the rate cuts were more induced rate cuts. It was not really required in the magnitude that happened. So, therefore, it is hard to say that we are in a structural low rate cycle, because as the economy, including the world economy, starts picking up momentum, invariably the rates will have to start taking a U-turn. It's just a small difference between taking a U-turn and a V-turn, because a V is a sharp V. So, that is pulled out. So I think we are in a phase where interest rates have kind of bottomed out, and while things will remain like this for some time, it will start steadily looking upward, which is good news in some sense for the savers, but that will be with slightly delayed gratification. So if there are investors who are looking to lock in really long-term monies, they clearly run the risk over the next 12 to 18 months. Even if interest rates remain here and start moving up gradually, they lose out on the potential higher carry that they can accrue over time. So my sense is therefore that it's good to have long-term investment horizon to keep volatility at bay, but be mindful of the mix that you would deploy when you are undertaking such decisions.
No, because you know the question why I asked you is because we are we have seen a change in behavior from investors. You know, they are ready to invest. You know, I remember there were funds which came for 10 years and there were no takers to it actually. You know, this was a few years back, the constant maturity funds, and you know, they have any AUMs. But today I see investors, you know, their expectations have mellowed. So they're just talking of, okay, if I invest for 10 years in a constant maturity plan, and if I get a better yield than a government security, you know, the tax-free bonds, which are available in the secondary market, I'm done with it, in fact. So, you know, that's one of the reasons why I thought I should ask this question, because there is a typical change in mindset of investors who are looking at investing in debt for a longer period of time also, in fact. Coming to a similar question based on this, you know, I don't know if you will be in a position to answer it because it's not exactly, it's not a mutual fund, but we do get a lot of queries from investors asking about, you know, these pension plans, which a lot of insurance companies are giving, and they are guaranteeing a rate of 6% for a long term, 15, 20 years, 30 years. I really don't know because we don't do it. You know, do you feel there is something to be cautious about for investors when they venture into these kind of assets? What is your take? If you if you can just throw some light on that.
So Nilesh, I will answer this question differently rather than talking specifically about the strategy. The biggest mistake I did in my investment journey was assuming that insurance is equal to investment. It took me a while to realize that insurance is nothing but a risk cover on your life. So have enough investments such that your risk cover will expire worthless. So it is more like a cushion on my investment portfolio. And obviously a cushion on my life. That's the way I learned it, you know, by actually in the initial part of my investment career, heading into, investment oriented insurance strategies. So I think here is my answer to all the viewers here. Try to stick to mainstream investments when you're planning investments along with your advisor, lump sum, staggered, SIP, whatever modus operandi you want to deploy, and use insurance purely as a risk cover. When you do that, what you realize is that when some bit of your term cover expires worthless, the wealth creation that you intended to do over the two decades or two and a half decades that you planned could be way significantly higher, and the small price that you've paid to buy that insurance for your own life it's okay to expire worthless. So that's the way I would look at it. Otherwise, every other form is just trying to stitch pieces of investments and make it available on a platter, which is something I don't do, at least for my personal investments.
So thanks, Lakshmi, for validating our principles also, because we advise investors on similar things, that you invest in insurance for risk cover, and it's an expense, it's not an investment. And invest in normal plain vanilla investments, be it even fixed deposits, not mutual funds, for creating, getting returns, in fact. So thanks for validating that, in fact. Coming to our next question is basically it's a more, a little related to the, credit rating methodology, in fact, whatever we saw during the pandemic, we saw, and before the pandemic also, you had seen these credit funds which saw back full of money which came in, and people invested without you know, expecting that, you know, there can be defaults in these kind of funds also. You saw the pandemic had, you know, one casualty, in fact. Okay. And so I won't like to name it, but, you know, you had a casualty, which I have never seen in my career of 20 years, you know, having schemes getting closed. So do you feel, you know, there is one question is this credit rating methodology, which is there, you know, it should include this illiquidity risk, which we carry in a fund, you know, which can't be liquidated in case of crisis situations, in fact. So do you feel that there has to be some change which needs to be done in the methodology?
So on the credit rating part, it is incorporating the liquidity profile of the issuing company. That is certainly taken care of. But if you ask for illiquidity as far as the bond market or secondary markets are concerned, it will be very difficult because those are ratings assigned based on qualitative and quantitative factors. But if I add that and I suppose the new riskometer which has come into vogue, which mutual funds are deploying, you'll actually see the matrix has been refined to actually include what you just said, which means what is the kind of liquidity, what is the kind of profiling, what is the underlying credit, all of that goes into forming of the riskometer. And depending on the scoring buckets, the riskometer changes depending on scheme to scheme. So for example, if you have a high grade portfolio, the tendency of the riskometer being in the same duration bucket will be a shade better. So the new refined riskometer which mutual funds are using today, which have underlying credits, actually account for some bit of illiquidity and credit also. So I think that will be the combined approach. It will be very difficult. At least I'm not able to envisage right now how a credit rating agency will, because it will become conflicting, you know, because they are not supposed to be tracking markets. They're supposed to be tracking the credit of the underlying company. So it's very difficult to see the two getting married. But credit rating plus riskometer getting married together, that's something which is finally getting presented to you and the investors, I think is a very logical step towards mitigating this risk.
Yeah, so what I can understand is actually, you know, it's not the purview of a, you know, of the credit rating agency per se, the illiquidity factor, but definitely we as advisors or like what you told the riskometer, if they can take into account, because I don't think most of us in the industry, you know, really took this, that there can be an illiquidity risk which a fund can carry because, you know, the pandemic also a lockdown we have not seen in the last more than 100 years. So the thing is definitely the situation was also something which was very different situation. But I think, you know, this is something which I'm sure we need to take into account in the future that, you know, in case if there is a run on the fund, will they able to sell all their securities and pay back the investors, in fact. So let's go to the next question. This is something about, you know, about the regulators now, in fact. So what's happened is, you know, what has changed post the recategorization of schemes, you know, which are brought in by regulators? Do you think it's a positive step for debt funds or is it detrimental? In fact, you know, there have been a lot of changes, you know, be it equity, debt, hybrids, you know, the scheme names have changed. People have got confused. All of a sudden, we go to an investor with a portfolio and they tell, ye fund kab liya tha apne, you know, and then we need to explain it to them that, you know, and then one more thing, you know, I think that's something which I feel is very good is credit risk fund is now written as credit risk fund. So the fund, right. the investor now understands that it has got a credit risk, which was not the case earlier. But do you feel, you know, what these regulators have been doing, you know, has it been detrimental? It's confusing a lot of investors for sure. But is it for their benefit or what do you feel actually? What is your call on it actually?
So, you know, Nilesh, again, let me give you the food analogy. If you actually go to an ODP restaurant, you have multiple variants of dosa. If you purely see dosa, a South Indian in me will say, okay, sada dosa. But, you know, if I were in Kerala, which is my hometown, there is something known as dosa and there is something known as ghee roast. Ghee roast effectively means the same dosa, but it is made in ghee. Likewise, there is a rava dosa, there is a masala, there is a Mysore masala. and to superimpose our Bombay Metro, or I would say Mumbai Metro palette, there is a spring dosa, there is a sandwich dosa. Why am I giving you all these examples? Is to tell you that it's no more a standard ingredient which incorporates just rice and urad dal and it's made and served to you. There are multiple variants. So just flip that into fixed income. It's not as straightforward as buying a large cap, mid cap or small cap. You are having a strategy which is extremely short and focused, and then you have a strategy which has only gilts, and then in the middle you have multiple variants of Jain dosa, which means that masala actually is made out of kacha kela, not out of aloo. So you have those multiple, and it's still called masala dosa, by the way. So I think it is very important that the regulator recognize this kind of a requirement and made it more streamlined for the investors to understand, such that when he or she comes into a credit risk fund, knows that you are going to take that element of credit risk, whether it fructifies or no. When I order a masala dosa at night, I know I'm going to add some carbs in my diet, not just from the rice, but also from the potato. So I think these are very welcome measures from my point of view. And I think once this has got streamlined and regularized, you can have a pure lentil dosa, and then you can have a keto variant also. That's yet to come. I've not seen that yet.
Okay. But has this made life difficult for you? Because of all the regulations,
it just allows you to, I would say, human beings got the habit of doing a quarantine just about 12 months back, but portfolios have been quarantined way before that because of these regulations. So it just brings about the much needed discipline. So we've been doing it for a long time in most of our strategies. So I'm happy that now it's become institutionalized at the industry level.
Okay, great. So, thanks for making it so easy for our investors, by giving examples, because I think fixed income is one of the most boring subjects, which typically investors, they sleep away over a presentation. But by giving these examples, I'm sure our investors are also understanding and enjoying the fixed income discussion, in fact. So taking you to the next, question, in fact, is, this is something to do with, what's happening is a lot of our investors, they used to invest in fixed deposits, in fact. And what's happened in post the lockdown is that the interest rates have gone down dramatically. I think they're at historical lows. We have not seen interest rates on a one-year FD at 5.75% since, I've never seen them, in fact. So the investors are definitely struggling, in fact. How can a debt fund fill in this gap? Is it possible to fill in a gap by getting a better return or a tax efficient return or something like what do you feel? Can it fill in this gap?
See, whatever you said is certainly possible. Fixed income mutual funds are a great vehicle to participate in the market related rates, which means the only stark differentiator while investing in a fixed income fund vis-a-vis doing FD is that the word guarantee or rate of interest assured is not there. But because it is not there, it allows you to participate in the market movements, and there are strategies, to suit your investment needs. It is not every day that you will go out in Mumbai or in Delhi or in Pune, wherever you are, in shorts and tees. That will probably be in summer. Whereas if it's in winter, you still require a light jacket or a sweatshirt and maybe long pants or capris, depending on what you're wearing. So what I'm giving you this example is that to every cycle of interest rates, like with changes in weather, you change your attire. With every cycle in interest rates, there are fixed income strategies to be used by the investor, but it's important to identify. And that is where I believe that the role of advisor is very, very important, because DIY or do it yourself need not really have the same outcome. It's very easy to Google and try to do self-treatment, but that's not really a recommended solution unless you are so arrived in life and you know it all, which even I don't think I know it myself. So I think it certainly makes a lot of sense to evaluate, explore, and plan these investments in line with your investment horizon, as fixed income solutions are there to suit every interest rate cycle.
And definitely for a 3-year plus investor, you know, you get the indexation benefit. So I think, you know, on a tax efficiency point of view also, you know, for a long-term investor, it does make sense, you know, about 3 years to get the tax efficiency, in fact. But, you know, one more thing, you know, this is something which was out of the, you know, it was not a part of what questions I had thought about. But, you know, we don't see too many FMPs. I don't know, means, you know, we used to have too many FMPs. Whatever FMPs are coming now are all AAA rated FMPs. We are not seeing FMPs with, you know, mixed category kind of for retail investors, in fact, or for individuals, in fact. So, you know, FMP has been one of my favorite investment products, actually, because your maturities are in line with the, you know, the time horizon for which you invest. And even during these bad times when there were credit related issues, I didn't see too many FMPs really having too much of a, you know, bad weather, in fact. Do you feel FMPs should be, means, what is your call on the FMPs? Should they be FMPs which should come back, or because I'm not seeing any of them of late?
So again, FMPs are a function of the interest rate cycle. Last 12 to 18 months were periods characterized by, you know, receding interest rates, where if you had exposure to any short to medium duration fund, you actually could participate in the upside. So you didn't really, you know, lock yourself with, you know, reasonable higher certainty of earning those yields in your portfolio. Now, when the interest rates are looking to stabilize and probably inch up, we've already seen some inch up in rates. Our sense is that passive strategies could make a comeback. It could be a combination of passive closed-ended funds or passive open-ended funds, you know, where you have a defined maturity that you have in mind and you let the portfolio recede or, you know, roll down, as you call them, roll down strategies. So a combination of these strategies are something which we could see as a very good complementing strategies in this kind of a market scenario. So yes, between, I don't know the frequency or I don't know how soon, but certainly in this kind of an interest rate scenario, if this continues, you could see these passive strategies come back to vogue.
Yeah, that's good news for, you know, FMP investors, actually, in fact. You know, coming to our next question, you know, this is to do with, you know, one investment mantra you have. You know, if you have investors, because I'm sure, you know, with the low interest rate scenario and with fixed deposits giving so low rate, there are people who are migrating to debt funds, in fact. So what is the one mantra you will give a new investor who just walks in and tells Nilesh Bajaj to invest in debt funds? In fact, you know, what is the one mantra you would give, actually?
So I will give him two mantras, him or her. One is investment, your earnings minus your savings is equal to your investments. That is what people always try to do. I always tell people that you first, people try to deduct their expenditure first. So I tell them you always make sure that whatever is left after your savings or all your investments should be your expenditure. So that is number one. That is the most important lesson that I try to follow in the investment world. That's number one. And number two is that fixed income is like lemon water. So it is a stability booster or a stability to your portfolio, whereas equities is like Red Bull. It's like the caffeine or the energy booster. So you require both the caffeine or the energy booster and the stability provider both as part of your portfolio. So ignore fixed income only at your own risk.
But you give really good examples. It makes, I'm sure our investors are understanding what, you know, the you know, the terminology, which is so tough for investors to understand, you make it so easy for them. So taking us to the next question, in fact, what's your view on yields? In fact, you know, with now, you know, definitely a lot of flows coming in, you know, there is going to be a lot of demand from the government also. What is your view on yields for this year, in fact?
So on the benchmark rate fronts, as I said, there is very limited scope for easing. Though we are in an accommodative zone, I would assign a very low chance of seeing any benchmark rate cuts. That's number one. Number two is yields are going to be a function of how the demand and supply dynamics will pan out. So depending on how the demand supply situation will pan out, we will actually see yields moving in a range. So the way the clock has a pendulum, you'll actually see a pendulum driven kind of a movement. And that will be a very range bound market, which could be frustrating. As a money manager, you will get really frustrated. So I think keep an outlook of stable interest rates, and probably towards the end of the year is where you would see gradual inching up of the rates once we have more clarity on the vaccination front.
Okay. Now coming to actually after the yields is credit now. In fact, you know, credit, we have seen so much of outflows from the credit funds, from the credit space, you can say, you know, be it medium term plans, credit funds, you know, the all the accrual funds which we used to talk about. I think January was the first month where we saw positive inflows in credit funds. You know, with the kind of inflows which is flowing into the equity markets and in fact even in the financial space, do you feel credit funds are here to make a comeback, and this is a good time to invest in credit funds, in fact?
See, you know, if you eat a bland diet for a very long period of time, your palate actually starts sinking. So you really require some spice. But if it is too much of spice, you know, then you really need to look out for sugar or you end up getting piles. So I think don't reach that situation where you have a huge overload of credit in your portfolio. But at the same time, don't make your palate so dry that you are completely going on a spice-free diet. So a little bit of spiking of spice in your portfolio through credit risk funds is absolutely okay. But keep it at the tail end. We clearly believe that there is a strong case for spread compression on the credit side this year, a thought that we've been propagating since April 2020, and it's actually falling in place. So we could see spread compression in the non-AAA segment in the coming year as well, which ties in with the positive economic outlook that we have in mind.
But, you know, one more good thing, you know, one needs to understand also was that in April, May, we were expecting a lot of delinquencies and a lot of drawdowns, which we were expecting from credit space, which actually did not happen. In fact, we didn't see any delinquency at all, in fact. And thanks to the government initiative also, but we really didn't see any kind of delinquency which has happened. And the spreads, like what you told, is very true. The spreads also are so, you know, have increased so much between AAA and a AA that it does make a case for, you know, investing, allocating some portion of it into credit, in fact. But, you know, I think, you know, compared to previously, now what's happened is, I think like when you invest in equities, you invest in small cap, mid cap, large cap, all different types of funds, and you diversify it. But I think in the fixed income category, long-term fixed income category, I don't think investors used to do that, actually. They used to just go and invest where the yields are high. So definitely, I think, you know, if you allocate some portion of the investments in credit, it'll definitely make sense, in fact. So thanks a lot. You know, this has been a wonderful this thing for the credit related this thing. Now, I think, you know, the last question to you is more to do about, today I just saw it in the newspapers, actually, you know, and that's again, the question that comes to me is, you know, with PF getting taxed, do you really feel that it's time for debt funds, where a lot of money flow can come into debt funds with PF interest getting taxed, and most of the CIOs and the top management now, you know, for them it's not going to be as tax efficient as it used to be before, as attractive as before. So do you feel there's going to be money which is going to come into debt funds? What is your take on that?
So, you know, Nilesh, every time the debt markets are singing this song, you know, if you remember this movie Gully Boy, they keep singing this song, Apna Time Aayega. And every time, you know, when they look at equity having 1 year capital gains long term and fixed income having 3 year capital gains, they say Apna Time Aayega. Then suddenly they see, okay, PF is getting taxed. And again, they'll say Apna Time Aayega. So I think that was on a lighter note, but on a more serious note, I think you will see some monies, you know, being channelized towards fixed income, where people are realizing that we need to diversify. It is good to have traditional mode of investments, no doubt about it. So, you know, if I have a cough and cold, what do? I will take steam. I will have a spoon of honey. All that is fine. These are my traditional recipes, which I want to follow, which my grandmother taught me. But I will also go by modern techniques, which is allopathy or, you know, those small steroids which are required to get me pumping and alive. So I think it's a combination of these two. This will not hurt, but this alone will not get you to the next level. So I think that is something which one needs to keep in mind. So naturopathy is one level, but you require the allopathy to, you know, get you back in good shape. So I think that's how one should treat fixed income. So please complement your strategies with fixed income. We are not talking about substitution. We're not saying that, you know, if you have a strong antibiotic, please don't take steam. We are saying please have both together to show proper recovery and better results.
That was fantastic. Actually, you know, the way you have made it, you made it into such a lively session, you know, and it was so informative. You know, I'm sure our investors will take away a lot of, you know, there are a lot of takeaways from our discussion today. So now I'll hand over this, you know, over to our viewers now, who I'm certain are eager to ask you some questions. So Harmeet, over to you. Could you just go ahead with the questions?
Sure, sir. A very good evening to all our viewers and a very good evening to you, ma'am. That was a very insightful session, ma'am. And as Nilesha said, a lot of analogies sort of made this session both education and entertainment. So yes, we do have a few questions for you. The very first question to you would be, what is your advice for a lot of investors who are looking to invest in very short-term securities? So you have overnight funds, liquid funds, dynamic asset allocation, not dynamic, sorry, low duration, ultra short funds. What is your advice to such investors who are looking to invest in these kind of instruments?
So, as I said, there is no one size fits all. All these are very, you know, pretty much available from the basket of fixed income options available. It has to match your risk appetite. It has to match your intended investment tenor. So, for example, if you come, you know, you come across an investor who will come and ask you, Harmeet, I have money only for 1 to 3 months. Is there a fixed income solution in mind that you have? So the answer is yes. So you do have liquid category funds. You do have ultra short term category funds. And then you have another investor who says that, you know what, I want to keep money forever. I don't want to touch it because this is linked to my goal of retirement along with my equity planning. So then, yes, you do have, you know, long-term funds. So I think there is a combination strategy that one needs to deploy. And yes, depending on your horizon, I certainly believe there are fixed income solutions possible.
Lakshmi, I'll just add to this. In fact, Harmeet, just give me a minute. In fact, you know, this is something which is actually confusing an advisor also. You know, the thing was earlier it was only liquid funds and liquid plus funds. I think there was no overnight category. You know, now you have is overnight, liquid, ultra short, low duration, and it's extremely difficult. You know, for an investor, if I put him in an overnight, he'll tell mera bank MD mein saving mein better return milta hai. Okay. So, you know, the buckets have become extremely narrow now. In fact, it used to not be the case earlier. You know, now you have, I think it must be, I'm sure it's to do with the regulators where they have come out with this. But, you know, the buckets have become narrower. So you have investments in each bucket. And I think it's only a migration which needs to be there. But, you know, it's definitely very confusing that for which investor, because, you know, an investor earlier, we used to put him into liquid fund, he used to stay invested for 6 months, he was fine in that. Okay, or he moves out in 1 month. Okay, but now with so many different variety of funds, you know, it's become a little tricky as to how do you actually invest the funds of an investor, in fact. So I think that's what the question must be from the investor, in fact.
No, in fact, Nilesh, I would say that all options are welcome. Today, if I want to travel to Pune, I can fly, I can take a train, I can go by bus, I can even drive down, I can do all of these things. Likewise, to Alibag, I now have a Roro. So that doesn't mean that driving is not correct. Driving will take me a longer time. Roro is going to be faster, but Roro will be slightly more expensive. So in the same analogy, if I put it to fixed income, there's nothing wrong in putting money in a liquid fund for 6 months. There's nothing wrong about it. But there is the potential, because of the shape of the yield curve where we are today, there is a possibility that an ultra short term for 6 months or a low duration for 6 months, despite that volatility, you know, a Roro is getting into water. So you might feel that, oh, you know, I might drown despite the ship is so huge. But the fact is it saves on your time. So likewise, there is the potential that these might be more volatile than liquid, but therefore it does have a potential to outperform. So there's nothing right or wrong. As I said, it's pure a function of your risk appetite.
So may I ask a question?
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Ma'am, so the next question is, do you expect inflation to increase going forward? And if yes, what kind of impact would it have on our interest rates?
So inflation is a monster. There is no doubt when that monster comes, sometimes it does a backdoor entry. Sometimes you open the door, it's right there and you cannot see. So it is really a monster. It's a real life villain, I would say. Even in Suraj Barjatia's movie, there is no villain. But, you know, in this movie, in a real life movie, there is this villain. And right now, inflation is in that twilight zone. You know, I call it the Trishanku zone. Now, it's somewhere in that twilight zone. And we think that with the hibernating period of maybe a quarter or so, inflation will start inching up again because commodity prices have started going up. While in India, the imported inflation is still not high because rupee is appreciating. But I think world over, inflation will make a comeback with a lag. And which is why, in line with that theme, globally, as I said, all this will not happen today, tomorrow, but with a lag of maybe 4 to 6 quarters, you will see globally rates also inching up to actually keep pace with inflation.
The next question, ma'am, is which between the two is better for a longer term, FD or a debt mutual fund?
It is asking you to choose between the parent and the child. I have a parent who is a bank and I am the child of that parent with mutual fund. So my answer to that is both are right in their own domains. If you want absolute certainty and you say, yeah, you know what, I have a car, but my car will always be in the garage. I don't even want to take it out because of the fear that it will give me a little bit of, I will not do an accident. But I am always fearful that, yahan se thuk jayega, wahan se dent aa jayega. Then first I would say, don't buy a car. And if you buy a car, don't keep it in the garage. So if you're that kind of an investor, then there is no option for you but to lock into certainty. But if you are an investor who are conscious, you are a safe driver, and therefore you will be absolutely mindful of the moves you take. You will not violate any traffic signal. You will be absolutely law-bound. And you are okay to live with small scratches, small dents, which anyways are covered under insurance. Then you should definitely complement fixed income along with your deposits.
That was it from the audience.
I think, Arvind, there was one more question which I can see. It's a very interesting question, actually, in fact. So we just take one question and then we can wind up because, you know, we need to keep, our time target also. This is, what is the percentage of savings one should do in fixed income instruments, in fact? You know, this is something which has come, you know, and I get this question from a lot of investors. So, you know, better to ask someone who is an expert in it.
So let me tell you something, okay? I don't need money for at least the next 20, 25 years. I'm okay because I have a regular stream of income because I'm employed in the financial services sector. And therefore, my portfolio, my personal portfolio is overweight equities. So I have a tertiary or a tail end allocation to fixed income. What is your persona? What is it that is driving your investment behavior? Do you need money in the next 2-3 years? Are you planning a capital expenditure? I think all of these questions are something which Nilesh will actually and the team will sit across with you and try to assess. And then this is that you have to decide what your fixed income allocation should actually be. But even to the most, I would say a risk-taking investor who says, yaar, kuch bhi ho jaye, yaar, dunia idhar udhar ho jaye, world to nahi khatam hoga, आई एम एन इक्विटी इन्वेस्टर डाई हार्ड. अगर ऐसे भी अगर इन्वेस्टर्स होंगे आई वुड से एटलीस्ट 10% ऑफ देयर ओन एलोकेशन शुड डेफिनेटली बी इन फिक्स्ड इनकम बिकॉज यू आर प्लानिंग फॉर कंटिंजेंसी. यू नेवर न्यू कोविड वुड हैपन एग्जैक्टली 12 मंथ्स बैक. You never knew the second strain would start hitting the way it is hitting the world right now. So there are so many imponderables, unknowns. So this contingency planning or this war chest of fixed income is precisely for that. So you might be very adventurous, but just keep your one leg to the ground for sure.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thanks a lot.
So again, ma'am, that was a very informative session and quite insightful. On behalf of Cedrus Wealth Partners, I would like to thank you and Kotak Mahindra AMC for making the time to grace this event. I would also like to thank all our viewers for tuning in such large numbers and making this event a success. We will return next week with a new topic and a new speaker. Until then, stay healthy, stay safe, and happy investing.